Your eyes while Gina turns on the lights and turn and tell somebody good morning. did the pop for us, so go grab a refill while I do the announcements. Grab some donuts. All right. If you have a Facebook page, go ahead and log in for me and check in so that people know where to come to church with you and enjoy and celebrate in fellowship. If you are new to Transformation Church, or if you are one of our family members already and you just have an address change or some information that needs to be changed, our transformation cards are right outside the door. This is also a great place for you to put your prayer requests on. You can put it in the offering basket or the basket on the table right outside. If you feel compelled to give today, there is a basket by the door for you to give in person. If you have cash, there's envelopes if you want your name on it. You can give online at findtransformation.com/giving. You can give on our app, and you can also text the word transform to 1-888-364-4483. We are happy to pray with you at any time. We fully believe in the power of prayer here at Transformation Church. Mr. Ritchie, does it work? Oh yeah, it works. So if you have something that needs to be prayed over, please write your prayer request on the back of a transformation card. You can submit your prayer request on the app or online. And you can also give us a text. Mr. Ritchie, you have something to say? That's awesome. Thank you, Mr. Ritchie. Also, next Sunday, I'll kind of say it again in a minute, but next Sunday is a great Sunday if you want to be prayed over with hands laid on you. And if you do not have our app, make sure to go ahead and download it. I've already mentioned multiple ways for it to be of use to you, giving, prayer requests, listening to sermons. This is also where you'll find the Bible study sign-ups and any other information that is upcoming. It's on Apple, Google Play, Amazon, and Roku. Our Freedom Small Group is starting back up on September 14th. It will be on Thursday nights. If you've already taken it, please take it again if you feel the desire to. If you've never taken it and want to, and you just have some questions, we're happy to answer any questions that you have. And you can sign up on the app or the website so you can get your name and make sure that we have a book for you. Men's group is meeting Friday mornings. James and Joey are getting lonely. So gentlemen, come on. So it was just James and Joey this last week, although he had a wonderful time in fellowship with Joey. So thank you, Joey, for coming. Friday mornings, and then women is Tuesday night at 5:30. At Rio Ranch as well, and we enjoy that every week, and it's a good way to meet at the beginning of your week. Ask the Pastor, or as I like to call it, Stump the Pastor, is coming up again in November, but make sure to get any questions or clarifications that you're wanting to Pastor Jeff by October 31st. You can text him, you can email him, however you want your questions sent to him, go ahead and do that, and he'll make sure to do the proper research for you and give you your answers. Next Sunday is First Sunday Praise and Prayer, starting at 9:15. We have 45 minutes of uninterrupted praise and worship time. This is also a really great time for us to lay hands on you, pray over you for those who are needing it. But it's a really neat 45 minutes that you get to spend with God before church starts. And then we get to spend more time with them. And it's in fellowship. We're all here. You can sing as loud as you want and nobody minds. At least I hope not. Nobody's told me. So go ahead and come and see how it is. It's amazing. So please join us next Sunday. Next week we will be continuing the Always God with week 5, Always Restoring. But today it is my turn to preach on the always pursuing God. So I'm glad that all of you chose to come and worship here with us today at Transformation Church. We always want you to know how much we love you. And as many of you know, our prayer is always that we're able to teach you to love God, love others, and to find freedom and to live the life that God designed only for you. For those watching online, the same goes for you as well, and we hope that you can come and join us in person sometimes. It is such a pleasure to be filling in while Mom and Dad are gone to share this message with you today in the Always God series. Mom and Dad are having a wonderful time in Colorado. They would like us to know that it is 53 degrees and just lovely. I know. But it's pretty great because my in-laws got to come today, so I get a really good mom and dad stand-in. For those of you who did not know, this beautiful cross up here, they made for our church. So it is absolutely gorgeous. This message has been more of a challenging message for me, more than any of the others I've given so far. Any of the other messages, God has given me the topic. He has reminded me of particular stories in my life that apply, and he's shown me the scriptures that he's wanted me to share. But this particular message was not one that was a topic at the forefront of my mind. I procrastinated when preparing for it. It came at a really busy time with the start of school being right at the beginning. And I had this looming standard over my head of having to make it as clear as and do just as good of a job as Dad does every Sunday. This message was one of the best challenges, though, as it has made me dive deeper into the living word. This message made me think deeper about all of who God is and all that he does for me. In this challenge, this message and this topic was given to me by Dad, right, where the topic was. The message was given to me by God, though. Although, of course, when Dad tells me to do something, I have a little bit harder of a time obeying, right? But that was even more of the challenge to this message. But in this challenge, I didn't realize at first, but God did give me the topic. God did give me the stories that I can relate to. And he gave me the scriptures that are ever important for us to hear today. And it was in the research and the studying of this always pursuing God that I got chills as I was reminded of my always God and your always God, our always God. This series has allowed me to be reminded that God is moving all the time and he never changes. God has not changed over time and we can still experience him every single day in a very real way because he is always here for us. Today I want us to look at how God has, is, and will always pursue his children. We are his children. I saw an article from PR Newswire that said that the average American spends 2.5 days each year looking for lost items. And it collectively costs the U.S. households $2.7 billion a year in replacement costs. Think about it. We lose that one thing, whether it be a sock, our keys, glasses, an important paper, and we look for it until we find it or just have to give up. I guarantee you, I spend 2.5 days a year looking for my cell phone as I'm talking on it. You know that feeling. We can lose just about anything, and of course, we notice when it is an item of high value. Nothing can be as hopeless or as frustrating as losing something important to you. Except that is until you yourself are lost. This makes me think back to times when I was a child in Walmart, and I'd be following behind Mom and get distracted by something, and I'd fall too far behind and just lose sight of her. As many of you know, I'm overdramatic, but this was a true situation where I was terrified right away. I was a kid who suffered from, or rather still am a kid that suffers from, separation anxiety. In that moment of losing sight of my mom, my heart dropped and I frantically looked around for her, and because I'm freaking out, not in the right headspace, I turn every which way, further disorienting myself and somehow getting further away from her. Of course, I eventually would find my mom, or rather, she would calmly find me less than a minute later. But for a little kid, it was a scary moment. I want to give you a moment to think. Think about a time that you lost something. Could be an item. And then also think about a time that you yourself were lost. Maybe directionally, maybe emotionally or mentally. How did you feel in both of those situations? I want you to hold on to those answers in your mind or write them down so we can refer back to them in just a little bit. Now, before we get into our text for today, let's talk about what we mean when we use the term lost. Well, Jesus takes this word lost and he applies it to describe those who are not in a relationship with him. And this word lost that he uses, it's defined in a much stronger way in the original language of the Bible than our definition of lost today. It's actually a word that means the state of being ruined. It means utterly destroyed and totally decimated. It's the same word found in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son that whoever believes in him should not perish. Same word, lost, to be wasted away, but have eternal life. So think about it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son that whoever believes in him should not be lost, but have eternal life. Lost is a good word to describe those who don't know Jesus. The Bible actually refers to those who don't know Jesus elsewhere in Scripture too, being hostile to God in Romans 8, being separated from him, having no hope in Ephesians 2. And in Colossians 1, he says being in a domain of darkness. So essentially, lost is not having Christ in your heart. But what if you once accepted Christ, but continuously get sucked in to a life of sin? What if you're not involved in a church, and you haven't maintained that relationship with Christ that you once had? Can you feel lost then? Absolutely. What about those who go to church, us here sitting in this room, and you try to do all the right things, but you allow the devil to get in the way and disorient you? Feel lost then? Think back to the feeling that you have when you lose something, or the feeling that you get when you yourself feel lost. Do you feel the same way when you lose some of your relationship with Christ? Do you feel destroyed, decimated, hostile, separated from others? Maybe at times you feel like you have no hope or that you're in a dark time. I wonder if God feels the same way when he feels you slipping away. When he feels that he is losing us because we're losing faith in him. There's a family board game that many of you may know called Clue. This is a favorite of James and mine. And yes, Clue, as in it was Colonel Mustard in the observatory with the candlestick. Hopefully, you're somewhat familiar with the game. Now, when playing Clue, you have to pay close attention, consistently. You have to ask the right questions to your opponents. You have to follow the right leads. You have to take notes and risks. And you have to be a little aggressive. And what I love about this game is not just the mystery behind it, but the fact that the game is not over until someone has chased the killer down, named the room in which the murder took place, and discovered the weapon that was used. There's no giving up, no quitting, and it's not over until what is pursued is chased down and found. As a player, you have to be bold, aggressive, and never give up. This brings me to our topic of today, the always pursuing God. There are so many different definitions of the word pursue. It can mean to follow someone or something in order to catch it. It can mean to seek, to attain, or to accomplish something, to explore or discuss. Take all of these definitions, involve them together, and you get exactly what God does for us. He is always consistently, aggressively pursuing the lost, pursuing his children. And remember, sometimes you and me, we can be lost. But the lost is a big population. Remember, the lost sums up anyone that does not have Christ in their heart. In today's reading, we will see this kind of bold, aggressive, never giving up kind of pursuit. We will read three parables that teach one big lesson. The reason for Jesus coming to earth was to pursue, chase down, seek out, and to search for those who are lost and in need of him. And in three of the most well-known parables in Scripture, all right here in Luke 15, Jesus vividly illustrates for us what this pursuit of the lost looks like. It is so important to understand what is being communicated when we say God pursues the lost. We are saying he pursues these types of people, those who are perishing, those who are wasting their lives away, those who are in a state of being ruined and in jeopardy of being decimated by the enemy, those who are simply put, lost. This is who God pursues, and this is exactly why in Luke 15, Jesus tells these parables to a bunch of religious leaders gathered around him that day. Jesus is blowing up their idea of what they think they know about God. Let's take a look at Luke 15, starting at the beginning of the chapter. Never in a million years did the religious leaders view God as a God that pursued those who were lost. So let's take a look. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to hear him. And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." They just found out that he's a God who sought after those who are not seeking him. He sat with the sinners. He was looked down upon at times. Commentator William Barclay says, "No Pharisee had ever dreamed of a God like that." A great Jewish scholar had admitted that this is the one absolutely new thing that Jesus taught about God, that he actually searched for us. A Jew might have agreed that those who came crawling home to God in self-abasement and prayed for pity might find it, but he would never have conceived of a God who went out to search for sinners. So getting back to our reading, Jesus starts to tell the religious leaders of the first parable, the parable of the lost sheep. Luke 15, 4 through 7. "What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost.' Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance." Here you have one little sheep that was lost, in danger, on his way to destruction possibly. Do you know who the sheep represents? It's me and you. Isaiah 53:6 says, "All of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have left God's paths to follow our own, yet the Lord laid on him the sins of us all." So we are the sheep, and the shepherd is who? Jesus, yes. It may seem foolish for the shepherd to leave 99 sheep to go search for just one, but the shepherd knew that the 99 would be safe in the sheepfold, whereas the lost sheep was in danger. Because each sheep, you and me, was of high value, the shepherd, Jesus, knew that it was worthwhile to search diligently for the lost one. God's love for the individual is so great that he seeks out each one of us and rejoices when he or she is found. Jesus associated with the sinners because he wanted to bring the lost sheep to the good news of God's kingdom. Before you were a believer, God pursued you, and he is still seeking those who were lost. Let's look at the next parable, the parable of the lost coin, in Luke 15, 8 through 10. Or what woman, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents. This coin is obviously of great value. Each Palestinian woman usually received 10 coins as a wedding gift. More than holding a monetary value, they hold a sentimental value, kind of like a wedding band. They are important to her for many reasons. And so this woman puts everything on hold until she finds the coin. Talk about a pursuit. She lights a lamp, she sweeps the house, she seeks diligently. Nothing else gets on her agenda until what is lost is found. And once she finds it, once it's tracked down, once the pursuit is over, what follows? Celebration and rejoicing. Thirdly, we have the parable of the lost son that occurs in Luke 15, 11 through 32. This is a story of a young, immature son who goes to his father and requests his share of the estate. As you probably are aware, in the time of the Bible, this is the equivalent of a son saying to his father, "You're dead to me. I don't want to be a part of your family anymore." Because it was only at the father's physical death that the son would have received his inheritance, asking for the share of his estate was rude and inconsiderate and taken as an insult to the father. The father, while brokenhearted, allows his son the freedom to make this decision, and he hands him over his portion of the estate. And the Bible tells us that his son went into a far country, and there he squandered his property in reckless living. It was soon after that that he had to hire himself out as a servant and take a job feeding pigs. Can you imagine anything lower for a Jewish man than feeding pigs? You see, nobody could tell a story like Jesus could. He had the religious leaders in the palm of his hand, and I'm sure they were thinking that this kid is getting exactly what he deserved, because to them, he was just a rebellious kid that was reaping what he sowed. And no doubt, he was. And he was absolutely miserable because of it. In fact, let's look at Luke 15, 16 through 24 to finish that story. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread? But I perish here with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran." Totally undignified in the day for a man to run like this, but his father doesn't care. And he embraced him and kissed him. And the son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." How many times have we felt lost, been lost, and we felt unworthy to be in God's presence? Kind of like the son. But the father said to his servants, "Bring quickly the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring the fattened calf and kill it, and let us eat and celebrate. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found." And they began to celebrate. What a picture. What an image a father running to hug and welcome his lost son home. I want you to close your eyes for a moment and place yourself in the worn down, miserable, dirty, and hungry shoes of the son. You feel unworthy, tired, and you just want to go home. Now imagine the father running towards you to greet you. That's God. The always pursuing God, coming to pick you up, dust you off, and hold you in the palm of his hand for eternity. And he starts your everlasting picture of love with an embrace and kisses. Does it give you chills like it gives me? Okay. It's a picture of God not only running toward the wayward and lost, but embracing him. You can open your eyes if you're still closed. God's still running after and pursuing the lost today. I read these three parables, and there's something that sticks out to me about them. The big idea, of course, is that God pursues the lost, but after reading and studying Luke 15 this week, I wanted to add a few words to our big point, and that is God pursues the one that is lost. Did you notice the word one in all of these parables? It's highlighted over and over again, and that's what I call the value of one. What man of you having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous men who need no repentance. Or what woman having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? And when she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, "Rejoice with me, for I have found the coin that I had lost." Just so I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents. The father, while he had two sons, it was the one that was lost in a far country that he grieved after and he ran towards. The infinite value of one. Just one. This value in the searching that takes place, leaving the 99, turning the house upside down, and then what happens once the sheep is found and back with his flock? What happens when the coin is found? What occurred when the son returned home to his family? Celebration and rejoicing. He picks up the sheep and puts it on his shoulder. The woman calls her friend and says, "Rejoice with me." The father throws a party, putting the best robe on his son, a ring on his finger, and shoes on his feet. You can't read these parables without understanding and seeing that God and all of his angels, they rejoice over each and every one repentant sinner. God grieves over every loss and rejoices whenever one, just one, of his children is found and brought into the kingdom. For those of you who attended the baptism this last weekend, what happened when your head came above the water? Your church family rejoiced for you. We gathered in celebration that you are making a physical dedication to your life of Christ. Reach out to those lost folks. Perhaps we would all be more joyous and have more joy in the churches today if we shared Jesus' love and concern of all of the lost, diligently pursuing them, and then rejoicing over them in a grand celebration when they come to the Savior. This is why God went on the ultimate search and rescue mission, leaving the confines of heaven and coming to earth. As he says in Luke 19:10, "For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." He came to seek. He came to pursue. He came to save. This is the good news. This is why Jesus came to earth and lived a perfect life and died for me and for you. It was the ultimate way God would show how he pursues us. It was the ultimate way God would show the lost how much they are valued, how much he loves them. Romans 5:8, that God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Don't buy into this idea that you don't matter, that your life isn't worth anything. That is straight from the pit of hell. Don't listen to the enemy telling you that your life is hopeless, meaningless, and that you don't have value. You do matter, and you have since before you were born. If you're here this morning and not in a relationship with Jesus, that means you are here this morning and lost. But God brought you here. If you're here this morning confused, wandering constantly, just feeling lost, God brought you here. God brought you here today as a way of pursuing you so you can hear this message of his love, so that you can surrender your life to him, whether it be for the first time or the thousandth time. Give up going your own way and give up doing your own thing. Give up running because you can't outrun the one who has been referred to as the Hound of Heaven. As Francis Thompson once wrote, as the hound follows the hare, never ceasing in its running, ever drawing nearer in the chase, with unhurried and unperturbed pace, so does God follow the fleeing soul by his divine grace. And though in sin or in human love, away from God it seeks to hide itself, divine grace follows after, unwaringly follows ever after, till the soul feels its pressure, forcing it to turn to him alone in that never-ending pursuit. God, the Hound of Heaven, will chase you down and continue to pursue you with an everlasting love. To keep running from him is to just keep hurting yourself. God, the great I am, not the great I was. The great I am, the always speaking, the always hearing, the always seeing, always pursuing, and always restoring God. That is who you have on your side. Think about this in the words that we sang today in Reckless Love by Cody Asbury. Before I spoke of you a word, you were singing over me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. The overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. It chases me down, fights till I'm found, and leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. Yet, you still give yourself away. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie that you won't tear down, coming after me. Church, let us rejoice in the fact that God is constantly and always pursuing us. He is coming after us because we are his children. We are his. I want to encourage those that are lost to run no more. God loves you. The value of one. And what happens once you allow yourself to be found by God? It's a party. It's a celebration. All of heaven rejoices over one person that is found. And that's what we're going to do here today. We're going to have a party over those that were lost but have been found, celebrating in fellowship in this very room. So let's end the message as we would a game of Clue. Who pursued you? It was God on the cross with the nails and his blood shed for us. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, I thank you for the truth of your word and the life that your word brings to us. Lord, give us a heart for the lost like you have. Give us the courage to pursue and pray like you do, Lord. Help us to value the lost like you do. I ask that you continue to help each of us in finding the design that you have planned for our lives, and help us to continue to look forward to what you have to offer for us rather than what is behind us. Heavenly Father, I thank you for your everlasting love and all that you have done for us. I pray that each of us are challenged to take a leap of faith and actively look for and pursue the lost just as you do. With all eyes closed and heads bowed, if there is anyone here today that is ready to take the next step and ask Jesus into their lives, right where you are, just raise your hand. No need to come down. I just want to give you the opportunity to know him and to be found by him. Now, as we all get ready to receive communion, let us cleanse our hearts and minds that we are better prepared to live out God's will for us. So if you would, repeat after me. Heavenly Father, I come to you today with my heart open. I repent for any wrongdoing that may have been offensive to you or others. Lord, thank you for finding me when I was lost. So now I can rejoice and celebrate with you. Lord, thank you for sending your Son to cleanse me of my sins so that I have a clean heart and mind as we commune together. In Jesus' name, amen. Alrighty, does anybody not have communion at their seats? Raise your hand if not, and I'm sure Kim can get it, or Annie can get it for you. Anybody not have any? We participate in communion every week because we believe it is worth celebrating as brothers and sisters in Christ. We join together as family to celebrate what would be known as the Last Supper. Jesus gathered in the upper room with his 12 disciples, and he broke bread. After washing their feet, Jesus took the bread. Let me take mine out. You gotta take yours out too. Lucky two today. He washed their feet, and Jesus took the bread and said to them, "This is my body, which has been broken for you. Every time you eat this bread, remember me." Then he took the cup of wine, and after giving thanks, he said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, which has been shed for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink of this cup, remember me." Let us rejoice and celebrate with God for just a moment. Because I just love getting to share in fellowship every week with all of you. Let's pray one last time before we go. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time that we have spent together learning more about you and worshiping in your holy name. As we leave this place today, may we be committed to worshiping and serving you in our daily lives. Lord, we are nothing without you, and it is in your power, your Spirit at work in us that gives us the strength and the courage to face this world in which we live. Lord, I pray that we surrender our lives to you, Lord God, for these lives that you have given us are not our own, they are yours. May every word we say be your words. May every breath we take be your breath. And may every move we make be your move. Lord, we don't want to just live these lives you've given us. We want you to live through us so that we may better serve you. All to you, Jesus, we surrender our lives so that we may be filled with your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go forth into the world in peace, loving God, loving people, finding freedom, finding your design, and celebrating. Thank you.